Hi everybody, thanks for tuning in today. In this video, we will introduce our beta prediction software, System Optimiser, and show you its latest features. Please understand that this is indeed beta software, it is a work in progress. You'll see things that are not finished together with things that haven't been started yet. Ease Focus is still available on our website, together with our loading and safety factor calculators, which must be checked before actual arrays are deployed in real life, for all safety factor calculations are currently hidden in System Optimiser until we have completely verified their accuracy. Okay, to download System Optimiser, you'll need to head to codasystemoptimiser.com, British spelling, and register an account with us. We will then send you a verification email. We've had some reports of this email bouncing to customers' spam folders, so have a look there if you don't see it come in. In the event that you do not get a verification email, please email systemoptimiser@codaaudio.com and we will be pleased to help. I should say that at any time, if you have any comments, queries or suggestions, please do not hesitate to contact us at this address and we'll be glad to help. Now, moving on to the login portal on the website, enter your details and press Login. At the top of this page, you'll be able to see the Mac, Linux, and Windows downloads together with the documentation. The standard release of System Optimiser requires AVX2 support on your CPU. If your CPU does not support AVX2, here are alternative builds of the application. If when you download System Optimiser, the application gets stuck on the splash screen, or the application does not draw correctly, it is likely that your CPU does not support the version that you downloaded. Simply try another version or contact us with the model number of your CPU and we will gladly advise which build to use. The latest release of the application will always appear at the top. Below this is another dropdown, where previous versions of the software can be found. The first time you run System Optimiser, you'll be presented with the Data Version Manager window. Its purpose is to download the data files that System Optimiser requires. If you stay logged into the DVM, you'll be notified of any available updates to your data files and will be able to install them with just a couple of clicks. To download the data files, log into this window using the same credentials you registered with on our website. Press Login. A table will now be shown with the name and status of the datasets associated with your account. Select the green Download button in the row marked as Compatible. Note that datasets marked Incompatible need not be downloaded. They're simply here in your account as they are required for older beta versions of the software available on the website as shown before. The download will begin and its status is shown at the bottom. It may take a couple of minutes to download the software. At present, each dataset is around 120 megabytes. I'll just speed this up now so you don't fall asleep. Okay, the download is now complete. Click Use. And now click the green tick in the bottom of the DVM window. The application is now ready for action. I'll just show you briefly around before we delve into operation. At the top right of the screen are controls for the light and dark colour schemes. Controls for zooming the UI in and out. These are also paired with the key combination Control plus and minus or Command plus and minus. Pressing Control or Command 0 will reset the GUI zoom level to standard. The cloud icon, when pressed, will relaunch the Data Version Manager window. Lastly, in the top right is a cog button which launches the settings dialog. There are three standard views presented within the application: Venue, Sources, and Rigging. I'll load a project now to make more sense of these. The Venue page contains the tools used to draw the venue. As standard, the atmospheric settings, venue settings, and grid settings are adjusted here. If for any reason your window doesn't look like this, say, for instance, you've been moving views about and you wish to restore them to their default layout, pressing Ctrl+Shift+P will launch the quick command line, where the command Reset View can be used to reset the views to standard. Most features within the software can be controlled with the quick command line. Have a play and see what you find. Here is the layer manager, where layers, be it quads, sectors, or free planes, are defined. When a layer has been defined, they exist as entities within the layer list here. These can be hidden, enabled, or defined as an acoustic obstacle. Pressing Scenery will remove the ear layer from the 3D view and will result in this layer being drawn purely as a visual aid. Layers can be grouped together for easy navigation. A group is represented with a folder to the left of its name. Clicking a group expands and collapses its hierarchy. Pressing this button creates a new group. Layers can be added into a group simply by dragging and dropping them on top of a group. The same is true for existing groups. In the bottom right of the screen are virtual camera locations. These allow you to jump quickly around the 3D scene. This is very useful for checking sightlines and working out where you'll inevitably have to reposition your arrays to so they aren't blocked by the unstoppable video screens. In the 3D view, left-clicking and dragging orbits the camera around the center point. Right-clicking and dragging pans the camera. Scrolling zooms in and out. Once you're happy with your camera location, click Store Camera found in the bottom right of the 3D view. Here, you can enter a name. Your camera will then be stored in the bottom toolbar. Right-clicking a camera location will allow you to either delete or rename it. Heading over to the Sources page, it's possible to see some similarities straight away. Over here is a 3D view, with the camera locations at the bottom. To the left, we have the Source Manager. Here, all loudspeakers within the scene are listed. Controls are provided for hiding and muting. If the loudspeaker source is stereo, two mute buttons are provided. Control group assignments are shown here. In this default layout, the control group controls are here. This button mutes all of its members. Clicking the pencil presents the relevant control group adjustment page. Now, onto pressure mapping. Clicking the SPL toggle in the top right of the 3D view enables or disables the pressure calculation. Center frequencies for the mapping are chosen here, with the bandwidth of the mapping being selected here. A new feature in version 0.4 is the ability to choose one of a few broadband mapping modes. Select Broadband here, then choose from EIA 426B, DINIC 268.1 filtered, white noise, or pink noise. Now is a good time to discuss the settings window mentioned earlier. Select the cog in the upper right corner of the application to bring it up. Tabs are arranged across the top. On the SPL rendering tab, the pressure mapping constraints are controlled. The color scheme for the mapping can be chosen here. There is a choice of Inferno, the default map, Rainbow, or Civitas. The SPL scale top and bottom anchor points can be manually adjusted in manual scale mode, or left in automatic mode, where there is a control for headroom and range. I'll leave it in this mode for now. A very useful button is the stepped scale button, where the presentation of the mapping can be quantized. Soon, I will introduce probes and mics. Their graphing scales are controlled on these two tabs. A new feature in this beta is the magical draggy-droppy tabs. Clicking one of these green plus buttons within the application will allow you to spawn a new tab. These tabs can be placed anywhere within the application. Have a go yourself. Tabs that were added to the view can be closed by clicking the red cross. To the right of all the views is a button which undocks the view into another window. These windows can then be placed on another monitor. See this real-world example that's absolutely not been photoshopped by an idiot. Right, back on program. Let's add some measurement mics and probes to the project. Press the green plus next to the 3D view and choose Microphones. Click and drag the tab to the bottom of the 3D view. Microphones can already be seen in the project here. Microphones are placed in a 3D view using this crosshair button. they show the magnitude response of the system at a point in space. Notice the low-frequency comb filter. This is caused by multiple sources being unmuted. Muting all but the main hangs clears up this low-frequency interaction in these positions. Probes could be added to the window by clicking the green cross next to the microphones and then selecting probes, but I'll demonstrate this instead with a quick command line. Once again, press Ctrl-Shift-P, then start typing probes. As soon as the QCL narrows down on what you're looking for, press Enter. Let's also open a side view whilst we're here. This latest beta of System Optimiser allows for multiple probes and side views to exist simultaneously. It is therefore necessary to target the view to an array. Click the crosshair and select the array that you wish to target. Note that the array now has a coloured outline for identification, paired with the colour next to the crosshair. When a loudspeaker is selected in the 3D scene, throw lines are drawn. These are green when they are hitting an audience ear layer, or red if they are not. There is an option in the settings window to choose between always showing throw lines, never showing them, or only showing them for selected sources. Probes may look similar to microphones, but they have a couple of crucial differences. They are, in effect, microphones which are automatically positioned at the intersection of each throw line and the ear layer. Their position is constantly updated as the inter-element angles within a line array are adjusted. Lastly, they only show the pressure contribution of their targeted array. They do not show the contribution or interaction of any other source within the project. Thus, they are very useful for adjusting the inter-element angles within an array. Now we'll take a quick look at the rigging page. On the left is listed all loudspeaker controllers found within the project. There's an important concept to understand at this time, which is clarified in detail in the operation manual, but for now, just accept that each controller can have one or more templates, which are configurations of loudspeakers. And each template can be placed one or more times within the project. This allows us to create multiple layout strategies very quickly. So back to this list on the left. Each top level entry in the project is a loudspeaker controller. Expanding these shows the templates within. Here, in the house delays controller, are found three templates, each with different configurations. Clicking these templates shows a side view here. To see a top view and data pertaining to each instance of the templates, choose which stack or hang to view here. A perspective-free overview of all loudspeakers within the 3D scene is shown here, with all instances of the selected template highlighted. Let's now look at the custom views, another new feature in this beta version. Next to the rigging page is another green plus button. Pressing this will create a duplicate of whatever view is currently displayed, and this view can be completely customized as you wish with any of the available tabs within the application. I'll create a copy of the sources page and name it calibration. I'll just add some items now to give you an idea of what's possible. Okay, well that's enough fun for one day. Hopefully you've now got a taste of what's possible with this beta, and maybe you'll find time to have a play and see what you think. As always, should you have any questions or comments, please email us at systemoptimizer@codaaudio.com, and we will do our best to help. Thanks for watching.